Welcome to Let's Talk Geek, episode 136, your dose for everything geeky. Except it's not just the episode, it's the whole show that's your dose for everything geeky. This is going to be a long intro because the rest of the show is going to be short. In the show, games, piracy, curiosity, stick around. Joining me in the show today, we have Luke.
Hello,
Luke. Can the mixer keep up? Johan.
Hello.
James.
Hi.
Jan. How you doing, mixer? Great.
Thumbs up. Thumbs up.
All right. So thank you so much for those of you joining us live that stuck around while we sorted out some issues with streaming. We don't know who to blame, Windows or Adobe. You are welcome to submit suggestions via email to wehateAdobe or Windows at letstalknetwork.tv, and that will hopefully get to us. We always start the show with the random, and this was kindly provided by Anonymous. 136 is a triangular number. The length of one side would be 16, as in 16, 16, 16 triangle.
Yes.
Excellent. Was it you, Luke?
Correct.
Ah, you claim it. Not so anonymous anymore, are you?
Oh. Oh, I forgot to put my name in. Oh, well.
So we're going to go straight into the quick geek. Luke, we're back at you. Curiosity's first year on Mars. That's pretty cool.
So the guys at NASA JPL have released a video time-lapsing Curiosity's adventures over the last year. The video is pretty sweet. It does lack audio, which makes it kind of eerie. But I guess that makes it kind of authentic in a way. In any case,
hold on.
Yeah,
is there atmosphere on Mars?
Very little, as far as
so
I understand.
So, what are you going to pick up on the audio?
Vibration? I don't know.
background noise.
Audio Martian ukulele players.
In any case, if you're going to compress 1 year into 2 minutes, all you're going to hear on the audio is.
It doesn't matter,
white
does
noise.
It?
But it's still a cool
it's
video.
The visuals. Yeah, it's you can see the Curiosity digging a lot. It's rad cool to see.
Cool. Then VR Paperboy with help from a Kinect and an Oculus Rift. Oculus Rift will be relevant later in the show. Mm-hmm. Remember this.
So these guys have just taken the good old classic game Paperboy.
I remember that. I loved and hated that game.
Yes.
And they've made it even cooler.
Yeah,
by adding the Oculus Rift and the
Windows shall be broken.
Sure, and off you go. So you physically control it by pedaling. It adjusts to your speed, and you can see like. You know,
so you get a stationary bike.
You get a stationary bike
and hook something up to the bike so it can like register your input.
It just registers your pedaling as your speed.
Okay.
How? How does it know how does it know how fast you're pedaling?
Maybe a pedometer in your shoe.
Yeah.
That might work. Yeah.
Okay. And then what does the Oculus Rift actually show you? Like whatever's in front of you. And then when you look left and right, you see how
you get the view as you would be on the bike. So you get to throw your digital newspaper into a digital postbox.
Or at digital grandpas or dogs. That's what you did in Paperboy,
exactly.
Right?
And then what killed you in Paperboy?
Cars
a lot
and
of
dogs
things.
And
yes.
the neighbors. And
it'd be quite tragic.
I can't even remember. It's too long ago.
Yeah.
All right. Very, very interesting. Yeah. Luke, because we didn't...
Yes.
it's you all three in a row. Researcher creates botnet-powered distributed file storage system using JavaScript.
So this is part theory but part practical. This guy has managed to make a botnet out of your average browser. They inject some JavaScript at you, and then you can use that to store files on other people's systems. It keeps tabs on who's online and who's offline and how many parts are available and all that distribution kind of stuff. And so if a node or a part is now low on peers, it will get itself resent around and adjusts for that kind of malarkey. So you could, in theory, safely store files on other people's computers.
Does it break them up into chunks that can't be...
And what they also do is that they encrypt each individual chunk, so it looks like random noise when you open the file up.
So what is this, peer-to-peer cloud storage?
Yes.
Cool.
No, scary.
It is very scary.
BitTorrent, BitTorrent themselves already offers something like this through their official BitTorrent clients.
This is
uTorrent.
You can
them?
Do like drive by. You can get unwilling participants. In
yes,
this
that's what makes this interesting. Yeah. Yes. All right then. All right. So I told you that the Oculus Rift is going to remain relevant. And it's going to be in about two topics time. This is leading into it. Doom. Johan?
Many moons ago, like in, at, I think, 6 hours
This is fantastic. Like, is there anything on the planet that Doom does not run on?
Well, apparently, beginning of this year, somebody got Doom working on a VIC-20. For those youngsters in the chat room, a VIC-20 like me. Dates like back me. To 1980. This introduced a home computer having only 3,583 bytes of basic RAM and 8-bit processor. And these guys have actually now ported Doom in there. Look, this is ASCII art at its best, but Doom is running in there. The audio is amazing.
Yeah.
For chip amazing. Audio, man. That's what makes it even cooler.
Yeah, right. And I told you that the Oculus Rift was going to be relevant. And John Carmack has joined Oculus VR. James, what is going on here?
Well, Carmack, co-founder of id Software, who created Doom back in the day and is sort of a industry legend, he was a big supporter of the Oculus Rift virtual reality headset. And he has joined on as their chief technology officer now. He remains with id as well, so he hasn't left. But he's going to be working on their project with them. The thing is still sort of in a prototyping development stage, and they don't have a retail prototype yet. That they're they've sent out the prototypes from the Kickstarter to the original backers and stuff. So the retail thing is the next sort of step. And yeah, I mean, who better than John Carmack to have on your team, especially since he loves this thing so much. I mean, he was a huge supporter of it when it was announced, and he's been talking it up ever since. So yeah, really cool.
Cool. And I hope John Carmack will see some success in his more experimental endeavors. Things haven't been going so well for his space project, it sounds like, and other stuff. So it'd be cool to have a win.
I hope this means Doom 4 will have Oculus Rift support.
I just wet my pants. It would have to come with like an adult diaper. Yeah. Otherwise, I wouldn't be able to play.
That's the collector's edition.
That is only going to be stocked.
There'll be
by Kalahari.
We're going to get to that one.
And the first web page is apparently 22 years old, not today, but yesterday.
Yes, 22 years ago yesterday, and I see we're missing the link.
I'll go find one.
It's on
Stardate.
Okay. Oh, cool.
If you actually go and click on yesterday, you'll see, there we go, the first web page is published. There's a couple of articles, obviously, about this, but the one in the Stardate's entry, which I'm pasting now, for those guys in RC, actually talks about the first page, which is very basic HTML. The World Wide Web is a world... is a wide area hypermedia information. This is basic HTML. That's all it said.
It's fantastic.
And a lot of sort of techie stuff about explaining what the World Wide Web
and
was
CERN
vision
and,
to be, which is the interesting part.
You could probably call this HTML version 1.
Maybe even Nordpoint something.
At this stage, he had sort of developed
it's got a head title.
No, that's what the web is, really, is Tim Berners-Lee sat down. Because the internet already existed before the web was built. So Tim Berners-Lee sat down and hammered out this markup language that I think he called HTML.
Yeah.
And it's actually built up over years and years of stuff that he had worked on. If you actually go and look at the at his process leading up to this point, like all the right things were in place for the web to be successful. So the web and HTML is only sort of one facet of what made the internet what it is today. This is just sort of the celebration of what brought the internet to the masses, I guess, which is the web. Very cool.
I just cracked open the source code, and it's the plainest website I've ever seen.
Sounds good.
That's what I say. You look at, but the fundamentals are there. Head, body.
Yeah, head, body, tags.
There we go. So, yeah.
Yep, before all the joys of cascading style sheets and having to support IE6.
And HTML5.
HTML5 is great.
And HTML5.
Then a little bit of local news. We ran a piracy survey on MyBroadband.
Yeah.
And MyGaming got to take a look at the numbers as well. And or did you run your own survey?
No, this was MyBroadband survey.
Okay, cool.
Sort of applied to both of us.
Yeah, and so SA Game Piracy by the numbers.
Yeah, we got about 5,200 people in the survey, so that's a very good sample, and you could say they're all very sort of tech-savvy types, being my broadband readers and my gaming readers. So, you know, we got a lot of 63% of the respondents on ADSL, 30% using mobile broadband, and then 4% wireless, 3% other.
What's other?
Wisps and stuff like that, I think.
I'm on a Wisp now. Sorry, not actually.
But that's wireless.
Wireless? Oh, did they have a category?
I think we added other because people, if they fill in the survey and they don't see something that they recognize as their internet,
why don't we just say we give them an out.
Like
it's a guy with a hard drive walking.
If it's dial up or fiber straight into the back of their head.
Because, of course, if they don't fill in what type of internet connection do you have, you can't continue the survey. So we have to put something there for those who say, whoa, I'm not any of those things.
It's a guy with a hard drive, and he just walks. There you go. That's the remaining.
Anyway, I mean, there are many interesting results, and we're still having a look at some of them. But the interesting thing was, out of all the respondents, a lot of piracy is going on, basically. And by far the most pirated thing was TV series. 80% of the respondents are pirating TV series. And then it goes down, movies, 70%. Music, 53%. Software, 38%. And I thought, interestingly, only 28% say they're pirating games. And there's an other category for
others. But James.
Yes. Oh, you're going to ask me why it doesn't add up to 100? Because you can pirate more than one thing at once.
I just couldn't get it up. But James, those don't total up to 100.
It was a multiple choice question. That's why. So, yeah, games are not on the top of the list. I think that probably makes sense. And we also, you know, you can go read the articles. There's a lot of reasons why people claimed that they pirated.
Oh, so you could actually also say why.
Yeah, you know, that we ran the gamut of reasons from convenience.
It's too expensive.
Basically, don't want to pay for it. I want to catch up with the shows that I missed on TV, or moral and ethical reasons. I pirate on principle is apparently a good argument. So, I mean, there's a lot to unpack from that survey. If you want to check it out, go read the
articles. Yeah, very interesting. Cool. And we could actually get stuck on this for a while, as we always do, but I'm going to move us straight along. And sticking with local gaming news, since we have you in studio, James, thank you so much for sticking around throughout it all. We're not trying to rip gamers off, says Megaron Manager from his car, apparently.
Yeah, he did a little, you know, like a one
drive-by.
Of those...
drive-by shooting of yourself.
Just a dash cam type vlog on his way to work. And I think it stemmed from a few issues that, you know, Megaron feels they've been taking a bit of flack lately. And for those who don't know, Megaron is one of the largest gaming distributors in South Africa. So they liaise with the publishers overseas, negotiate a price for importing a bunch of games in a container, and they lock in that price. And then they get it out to the retailers, who then also have their own effects on price. Apparently, if you want to believe what Megaron manager says in his video, they're taking a lot of flack publicly, being blamed for high game prices in South Africa, and they don't think it's fair because they say they do their best. I mean, on the one hand, they are a business and they have to make a profit and they have to pay their employees and, you know, make sure everything carries on so they can bring games into the country. But on the other hand, they're not trying to rip people off, and they just don't like the negative feedback. So he just took to the internet and got his opinion out there to let people know, hey, we aren't pirating. We aren't trying to rip you guys off. With high game prices.
It's curious to me that people would feel that way. Look, I understand that console games are expensive, but they don't strike me as that much more expensive than if you would buy them overseas. And our PC games are really competitively priced in this country compared to the $60 or whatever it is that you pay for a AAA title.
I think it's a very knee-jerk reaction from local gamers who, and fair enough, I think, you know, the guy mentions, like, you don't understand maybe when you make these comments what goes into it. And if you draw some comparisons between American and European markets, far more mature, and sort of do some direct pricing comparisons, we actually come in a bit cheaper more often than not than what these guys are paying overseas. And that's after it's been shipped here. We're very marginal markets. So, you know, they're not making, you know, big profits on economies of scale and that sort of stuff. So the guys are actually doing a good job of keeping our prices down. Obviously, there's a bit of understanding from the publishers, international publishers' point of view, that if they want to sell games in South Africa, they're going to have to keep the prices reasonable within what we expect to pay. So, you know, there's a lot of negotiation that goes on. It's not just as simple as Megaron saying, we're going to charge 900 Rand for GTA 5. And I think GTA 5 may have been one of the big ones that sparked this whole thing, because that is one of the, well, if not the most expensive.
Pay for that. Yeah.
Yeah, it's probably one of the most expensive games in South Africa ever at a launch price. It's basically 900 bucks for one of the standard editions. Now, it gets complicated. Retailers have dropped their prices. They want to attract customers, so they're offering, you know, 600 Rand and maybe 550 Rand for that game. But they're taking the knock, and, you know, it gets complicated. So, yeah, it's just interesting.
Yeah.
And so, this now actually ties into, I think, the next topic.
So some questions from IRC that I think we should answer is, A, what car does he drive? I didn't notice, but it did look fancy. It had, like, a start button and stuff, keyless entry and all that.
I think it was, a fairly you know, mid-range Toyota something.
Sure.
It wasn't like a Porsche. So
No. Yeah. It was
that's
like
what you're getting.
It was like a respectable middle class, middle class car.
You know, like a small hatchback. That, so.
One comment is, I don't see Megarom execs getting any poorer.
Well, I mean, again, like, do you guys expect them to live in a cardboard box so that we can pay 50 Rand less for a game or 100 Rand less for a game? I mean, again, it's a business.
Might be a Honda Civic, basically, by the way, from the comments.
As if it's relevant. It's not an expensive car. Like,
anyway, and then a question that I think is actually quite pertinent based on what we discuss in the show often is, how much does it cost us to then update those games via ADSL and stuff? So obviously that's not something the distributors can control, but it's an interesting question. Yeah. I mean, it can get quite expensive for games.
Yeah, I mean, maybe it's, you know, is factored in. Gaming is an expensive hobby. You know, you don't get into gaming as a hobby thinking everything is going to be free. This is another topic that was come up recently, where one of our local industry stalwarts, Michael James, editor of NAG magazine, was saying gamers will spend whatever it takes to keep them going in the hobby. And generally that's because we are a high income bracket type who have already spent the money on our equipment. Yes. So, you know, we do have jobs and we do have enough disposable income to afford entertainment products like games. So, you know, we sort of feed our own habits in this way.
Yes.
So a question, by the way, and I know we're going a little over on this topic, but this was like the topic I wanted to discuss in depth in today's show anyway. The question I really wanted answered, more than, you know, raging about why things are so expensive, I want to know how things are so cheap, actually. And that's a question I've never really had adequately answered. Like, how is it possible for not just Megaron, but other distributors as well, to ensure that games come in at, you know, 350, 400, sometimes 450, sometimes 500, depending on the publisher. You know, how do they get PC games in at those prices where they cost $60 in the States for AAA title?
Again, like, I think you said it already, it's really a lot to do with the publisher. And, you know, whilst the distributor has some negotiating power with the publisher to say, oh, we don't think that game will sell at this price, and, you know, we these are our margins and we've got to get it in at this price to be able to make profit, and we project we can shift this number of units and stuff like that. At the end of the day, the publisher can say, we don't care, sell it at 900 Rand because the game is worth it. Or they can come to the party and say, okay, if we want to sell games in this market, we're going to have to keep the prices down. And For the most part,
the publishers are actually kind of nice to South Africans. They're like, the poor South Africans can't afford this.
Well, yeah.
So,
I mean,
we better sell the games at a more affordable price.
It's debatable whether they're nice or if they're just saying we can sell games, and selling games means profit. So,
yes. Yeah.
At the end of the day, that's what they're going to do. That's what it takes to sell games.
Yeah.
I think that is the core of it.
Why
our games are cheaper than more established markets, where in Europe they'll say these guys can afford and will pay 60 euros for a game. And that's the price we'll set it at.
Yeah. Well, and this leads into, as you alluded to earlier, this leads into a similarly contentious topic about the whole pre-order incentive exclusives. That seems to have, you know, it's something that we see a lot in the American press with GameStop and those guys.
And you get a bit of DLC, unique DLC that nobody else can get on launch day.
Or something.
I've always hated that terribly.
Yeah.
Or something that comes with a game box.
Exactly.
And we're starting to see that in South Africa.
Yeah. And again, one of the retailers contacted us and wanted to remain anonymous because it obviously stirs the pot a bit. And they said, it's nonsense that one retailer is getting preferential treatment, it seems, in terms of what pre-order incentives they can offer. And that sort of affects everyone's ability to be competitive, because gamers, we aren't particularly loyal in terms of who we'll shop with, we'd rather get the cheapest option or the best option for our money. And if the best option for our money is a game with a cool DLC from retailer A, and retailer B, C, and D don't have that offer, obviously we're going to retailer A.
I think there might be a historical aspect to that as well, because you'll find that like GameStop in the past was probably, you know, one of the only places that you could get it from, and then over time, you know, the publishers are leaning back on those guys and saying, here, you know, thanks for your support.
Yeah, I think there's a lot of factors. But, publishers will say, who's got the best visual presence? And I mean, let's not beat around the bush. BT Games gets a lot of the exclusives, but of course, they have the best physical store presence out there. And no other retailer has that sort of penetration into the retail space, at least. So eyeballs on game shelves.
Yes.
And the other guys are competing online to offer you incentives to buy their games. So they usually take a knock and try and reduce their price to entice customers back onto their site. What was the question there, Jan? Why? Basically, because the publisher said so is what we got to at the end of the day. It's not an answer that people like, but you know, that's the way business works sometimes, I think.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. But it sounds like these types of deals come up because the retailers are kind of feeling... Well, that's the impression I get from reading international media, that retailers feel hard done by.
Yes.
So, you know, all this stuff is coming out on Steam, and you have digital deluxe editions and all that kind of stuff. And why should a gamer buy the game, like a physical copy of the game, when he can preload the game when he buys it on Steam for the same price? Mm-hmm. He doesn't get a physical disc or anything, but that's largely useless thanks to DRM. So, you know, why bother? Why go to GameStop if I can just get it from Valve? And so GameStop goes to the publisher and says, I need a reason to stock this on my shelf.
Yeah, that's also a good point, yeah.
I know Jim Kazition, that's usually how he, or one of the arguments that he makes about it. Anyway, so I'm getting a signal from the mixer to move it along, but sticking on the side of retail, BT Games has launched a digital download store.
Yeah, I mean, that one can be kept short and sweet. They have now got a section on their web store where you can buy game codes, Steam or Origin or whatever. It's not officially launched. It is functional, but they haven't, you know, they're still building it up.
Okay, but now what would be the advantage of going to them over going to Steam?
Well, that's what we're waiting to actually see, whether they'll be able to compete in some way. Maybe they've managed to strike a deal you know, directly with publishers themselves, or what is actually going on there. So, you know, they weren't really willing to talk about it. They want to launch it or whatever, but the knowledge that it's coming is out there at this point.
So. You have my interest.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, so we'll see how they compete.
There's still a lot of people that believe that to pay in rand is better than pay in dollars.
Yeah, and so to support a local store rather than, you know, directly supporting an American store.
You want the game stores to be around.
Yes. So, yeah, I think that's all very nice, but at the end of the day, if Steam can beat their price by 10 rand, I bet you people will just buy it on Steam. They won't care that they're supporting BT Games.
So, given enough time, the exchange rate will do wacky stuff.
Yes, exactly. So it'll be interesting to see how they do manage to compete like that.
But it does speak, I think, to a desire to remain relevant. I think it speaks to the fact that that they are seeing a change, a shift in the way that the South African market's buying, and I think that in itself is significant because it wasn't a concern, but they've seen that it might it is becoming a problem or it might be becoming a problem, and so they've had to respond.
So
good on them. I mean, I actually prefer to buy my games through the Humble Store because that gives me not only a DRM-free version of the game, but it also gives me a Steam code, depending on the game developer, obviously.
And an Android version sometimes.
This is not on the bundles, but the guys who list in the Humble Store themselves, you can actually buy anytime, not just when the games are on special. You get a Steam code through that way as well. If BT Games is willing to compete and offer, you know, sort of a similar, like we give you Steam, but we give you something else as that could be good.
Definitely be interesting to see how they take it forward.
I mean, many years ago, everybody told you don't use an open Wi-Fi port, Wi-Fi system. Now, that's common knowledge. You sit in a Wimpy, always on, it's open. There's no encryption key. So I just wanted to ask a question. So what's changed? Is that still a rule, or do you now just accept that all your access from your machine will be encrypted?
Yeah, so this is now, and it's an interesting question because it's something that the Always On guys, it's a question that has been posed to the Always On guys, and they said, no, it's absolutely fine. It's secure. And I don't, and all the security professionals I've spoken to have said, stay away from that stuff because while you still, you do have to type in a username and password before you can actually do anything over the connection.
No, but that's just to open you on the router
yep.
board.
Yep. The fact is, I think
over
that
the air communication is still unencrypted.
I think so. I speak under correction, but generally, unless you are doing something that is locked down over a VPN or otherwise encrypted, it's a really, really bad idea to try and do it over an open Wi-Fi.
Now, in what sense? I mean, is somebody going to hack into your device, or are they just going to intercept
what you're doing? They don't even have to intercept the thing. Board. They can just see it. They can just see the traffic, all the traffic that flows over that hotspot.
Okay, but like, so if I'm just bored at the coffee shop and I'm browsing the internet and not doing anything serious like internet banking, you know, whatever, they can see
then
what I'm browsing.
Cares. Yes.
Yeah, then who cares? But if I'm a fool and I go and start doing internet banking over their open access Wi-Fi connection, then what?
But again, internet banking is usually secured by SSL, so trying to hack that is a little trickier.
Okay. Accessing years your ago, Gmail account, perhaps?
No, also SSL.
Okay.
So, but there are websites, I don't want to name names, but there are websites because we're guilty. But it's also, SSL certificates are expensive and they slow the sites down and it's not necessary for something that's not hyper, that doesn't need hyper security, right? So, so there are sites that don't implement SSL and usually don't need to. But it's going to be a problem. If somebody sits on that network, your password is transmitted effectively. Well, it should be hashed before it gets sent to the server, but the hash is plain text. Mm. And so if the guy, you know, with enough know-how sits on that connection,
yeah,
he could hypothetically, even with SSL, this is an article we recently did, SSL is actually it's quite secure, but there are ways of it's targeting attacks at people. Yeah. And get their information. Mm-hmm. And if you're on an open Wi-Fi AP, that's one less barrier that they need to cross to get it, what you're transmitting.
Now, my other question was the fact, okay, that's all now from a desktop. Now, what happens in the mobile world?
Same thing. Same thing applies. It's just a PC that's smaller.
And yeah, so but at least in a PC world, I can control. Okay, I'm going to climb on this Wi-Fi. You know what? I'm going to close all these services, and I'm not going to mention them. So we know they're not communicating because I just want to go to Google. Okay, all right, great. Log in, there we go. Mobile, you can't control that access. I mean, when your phone climbs on a Wi-Fi access point, how do you control what it does and what it doesn't do?
Yeah, you're going to have to go into all the running apps, force close them, make sure none of them are running.
Mm. And that's high-level stuff for people.
If anybody out there knows of any way that you actually secure your phone in that fashion.
I have an app that does do that. I met the guys at CES this year. It costs money, but it's effectively a one-touch VPN service. It's like strong VPN for your phone. But it's one touch, and they run through a couple of points of presence: one in London, one in the UK.
Even with the
one in London,
you're
one in the US.
To climb on the Wi-Fi before you can initiate the VPN.
No, you would initiate the VPN before you climb on the Wi-Fi. You can do that.
Let's come back to that.
Sure. I see what you mean. So, in other words, there can still be a man in the middle attack.
Because
when you re-authenticate to the VPN after you've climbed into the Wi-Fi is basically what
you
mean.
Well, I'm saying you're going to climb on the Wi-Fi because you need to connect to the Wi-Fi before you can initialize the VPN.
Yeah, to re-initialize it, absolutely.
And I'm talking about that communication in that period.
I did not ask them about that specifically, but it is an interesting question that we can pose to these guys because that is something I have to guard against.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Yeah. Cool.
I'm not paranoid. I'm just visiting a city where I'm going to be walking around and there's going to be a lot of open Wi-Fi spots that people say, go ahead, use it, it's fine. But I'm just like that initial communication from my phone to whatever. That's the one I'm worried about.
Yes.
The rest of the stuff I can control. I can make sure, don't open this, don't open Facebook. You can do that. It's just what goes between a phone and the network and Google basically when a phone climbs on a network. That's what I want to know.
Mm.
And how can I just control that communication?
Yeah. Yeah. All right. We're going to end this. We always end the show on something a little bit cool and interesting and funny at the same time. And this week, it's XKCD that makes it into the kicker. Luke, you found this. It's a 3,099 panel comic.
Basically, what started was that back in, I think it was March, XKCD, he posted a comic. And the comic made no sense. And what happened is, every half an hour, people noticed, but hey, the frames changed. And so it became quite an adventure for people to track what's happening on this comic. And so it spanned 3,099 panels. You can watch all of it in a 40-minute YouTube video, or you can click through it at will via some links that will bomb into IRC.
Unbelievable.
And It's quite amazing what a community sprung up around this thing as well, because then there were whole wiki pages set up to, you know, discuss what the hell's going on and, you know, what can be happening within the scene and so on. And eventually, after this had all concluded, then the Wired guys went over and interviewed Randall Monroe and to get his feeling on what's going on. And then he explained the story in great intricate detail if you're interested in that kind of stuff. But I just think that's a cool idea. So, you know, having a comic that isn't necessarily funny, but you have a point at the end of the day. It might just take a long time to
get
there.
Was there a punchline?
There was no punchline.
There was a point.
It just ends, to be fair, as far as I can see.
It's maybe he's still working on the punchline.
It's Randall Monroe, like, doing his... Because he's also done comics that are massive, that are just like these massive gigapixels. He uses funky techniques to make them smaller, but you can't see the whole scene at once. They're just so big. And so you have to scroll... Like, you know, you grab the actual image and you scroll it around with, like, your mouse cursor.
We sat you one night during the show.
Yes.
And we just kept on scrolling. We did a whole show. Couldn't get the end of the scroll.
Yeah. And somebody actually went, pieced together the tiles. I think he wrote the script. Yes. Grabbed the tiles and patched together that whole comic. So Randall does these cool things from time to time. So very good job. And that's why he'll always have a have a spot in the hearts of geeks around the world, I think.
Can I just come back to one thing, one event, just one event? Next week, 13th, is Left-Hander Day. So if you know anybody with a left hand, also.
I've got a left hand.
Sinister.
That uses the left hand. Just congratulate them.
Sometimes use the left
Tuesday
hand.
Next week.
Okay. And you can also check out Stardate Saturday today for more events. And GeekFest is coming up on the 31st of August. We'll talk about it hopefully again a little bit. No, they won't. Maybe next week. Just brief people a little bit more on that. With that, thank you so much for joining us, and we'll see you again same time, same place next week, if all goes well. We'll keep you updated. If things do not go well, you know, work happens sometimes. You can also check out the rest of our shows on YouTube, youtube.com/letstalknetwork. youtube.com/LTStarNetwork. You can check out other shows on the network. Let's Talk Possibility. Let's Talk Hack once a month. Gentlemen, thank you so much for joining me. James, where can people find you?
I think My Gaming on the forums is the best place to come and harass me. So head over to mygaming.co.za.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Johan, where can people find you?
www.u-els.co.za.
Cool, which is where we're streaming from tonight. Thank you so much, Johan, for letting us use your website. Luke, where can people find you?
Twitter, FRK, yeah.
Yeah.
Sweet. I'm Jan Vermeulen. You can find me on mybroadband.co.za or Twitter at JanVZA or Google Plus occasionally, Jan Vermeulen. And I post stuff on Facebook too using Buffer. I don't know how to use Facebook otherwise. I just use Buffer. The Mixer. Can I tell people where they may find you? Yeah. Behind the mixing desk?
Yeah, wave.
Once a week?
Do the queenly wave.
At AnnieBugZA on Twitter. You may go ping her there. She also runs the Let's Talk Geek Twitter account. And you can ping her there too. Thank you so much for joining us. We'll see you again next week.
Thank you.